Today on History in Bits, we're looking at medieval consanguineous marriages. In other words, inbreeding. And how this rather awkward topic plays out in Crusader Kings 3. For this one, we had to do a bit more than just historical digging. We've also tried to wrap our heads around the biology and genetics involved. So here's the plan. First, we'll introduce you to the inbreeding coefficient, a concept worked out in 1921 by the American geneticist Sewall Wright. Then we'll see how the game takes the idea and turns it into mechanics. After that, we'll look at some real-world examples from history. And finally, something we've not done before in a CK3 video, we'll run a playthrough to see just how the game handles inbreeding when you actually push the limits, and we'll even go for the infamous Perfect Circle achievement on Steam. It's a bit of a touchy subject, and in the CK3 community it's been memed to death. And I hope it goes without saying that, of course, none of this we condone IRL, but nonetheless, it's a subject that historically took place IRL, and is a significant game mechanic in Crusader Kings 3, and we think you'll find it fascinating. If you do, drop us a like, subscribe, and let us know in the comments what else you'd like to see us tackle. In 1921, American geneticist Sewall Wright defined what is known today as the coefficient of inbreeding. It's essentially a way of calculating the probability that an individual has two copies of the same gene at a particular genetic location because both came from a shared ancestor. This happens when parents are related. They share common ancestors and genetic material is passed down from those ancestors on both sides. That means a child might inherit the same allele, that's a variant of the gene, from their mother and their father, both of which are copies of the same allele found in that common ancestor. This is a problem because most genetic disorders are caused by recessive alleles. Normally, these are harmless because they get masked by a dominant healthy allele. However, when related individuals mate, the chances of both parents carrying the same rare recessive allele inherited from a common ancestor and passing it onto their offspring is much higher. Wright worked this out mathematically. His coefficient adds up all the probabilities of someone inheriting the same allele from both their mother's and their father's side. Since each parent has a 50% chance of passing on a particular allele, the formula is built on 0.5 to the power of the number of generations the shared ancestor is away from the parents. So let's take siblings as an example. If your parents are brother and sister, your inbreeding coefficient is 25%. That means that there's a 1 in 4 chance that, at any given genetic locus, the two alleles you inherit are identical by descent, both coming from the same grandparent. As you can see, the more generations that practice inbreeding, the higher the coefficient gets, the more predictable the genetic outcomes become, and the more likely the new generations are going to have inherited disorders. Sewall Wright's coefficient is also the basis for the mechanics in Crusader Kings 3. Of course, the game simplifies things, and doesn't calculate probabilities for every allele. Instead, it looks at how many common ancestors two parents share within the last four generations, and uses that to determine the risk of negative traits. The more shared ancestors, and the closer those relationships, the higher the in-game inbreeding coefficient, or inbreeding factor, becomes. And just like in real life, the higher it is, the more likely children are to develop negative congenital traits. Above all, the inbred trait itself is a direct representation of severe genetic disorder. But there are plenty of other possible traits too. Barren, scaly, club-footed, wheezing, spindly, giant, hunchbacked, bleeder, and dwarf. On top of these, there are also positive traits, such as genius and Herculean. These are usually the justifications for players seeking out interfamilial unions, as they follow the same rules as above. One unrealistic game mechanic that's worth mentioning is the pure-blood trait. If one parent has it, the chances of negative inbreeding effects are halved. If both do, they're eliminated entirely. You've also got the blood legacy dynasty tree, which will increase the chances of inheriting good traits and decrease the chances of bad traits. It makes for interesting gameplay, but scientifically, it's of course nonsense. Anyway, when you arrange a marriage between two characters, the game automatically gives you the risk of their offspring being inbred as a percentage. But what's the actual formula the game uses? While the Paradox Wiki only gives us this graph that gives the final chance of bad traits based on the common ancestors shared by the two parents in the last four generations, fans have deducted from this the following formula. You basically count out the number of common ancestors of the two parents, with up to 30, since only four generations are considered, multiply by 5/3 to get a relatedness coefficient, and then again multiply by 0.3. That gives you the final percentage. Compared to Wright's real-world numbers, CK3 is a bit generous. For example, the real-world coefficient gives a 25% risk of negative consequences for siblings having children, but in CK3, it's only 15. And while this formula aligns with the wiki entry for siblings and half-siblings, it is slightly off for cousins, as the game only gives 5%, while it should actually be a 7% chance IRL. In other words, since consanguineous relationships in real life are a bit more risky, don't try this at home, kids. But in CK3, if you're not deliberately breeding for traits, you're generally safe, as long as you don't marry anyone closer than a second cousin. Finally, there's also the question of legality. In CK3, whether a close kin marriage is allowed or not depends on your faith's consanguinity doctrine. If your faith forbids it, your character will get the incestuous secret, or even the trait if they're exposed. On the other hand, if your faith has unrestricted marriage, by adding the divine marriage tenet, then marrying family members can actually boost your vassals' opinion and earn you extra piety. In actual history, the Christian Church's stance on consanguinity was quite strict up until the High Middle Ages. According to medievalist Constance Bouchard, because of the Church's strict stance, at least in the 10th and 11th centuries, powerful nobles gave serious attention to consanguinity when arranging their children's marriages. While it later continued to discourage close cousin marriages, dispensations were increasingly granted for powerful rulers in the late medieval and early modern period, as we shall see in our next section on historical examples of consanguineous royal marriages. When it comes to famous dynasties, none are more associated with inbreeding than the Habsburgs. In the High Middle Ages, when the dynasty was still on the rise, things were relatively unaffected, but from the 16th century onwards, the infamous Habsburg jaw, the result of excessive inbreeding, became a real problem. The worst case of that, of course, is Charles II of Spain, nicknamed the Bewitched. He was the son of Philip IV of Spain and his niece Mariana of Austria, and had the highest inbreeding coefficients of all the Spanish Habsburgs, who were already the top-tier league of consanguinity. I never thought I'd have to say that sentence in my life. Anyway, his life was plagued by disability. He didn't walk until he was 8, suffered epilepsy throughout, and his jaw was so deformed he struggled to chew. As 20th century historian John Langdon-Davies aptly described it, from the day of his birth, they were waiting for his death. He had nothing with which to fight, neither sound body nor sound mind, yet he blundered through his life trying to do what was right. His inability to father children finally led to the War of the Spanish Succession, and after his death, the end of the Spanish Habsburg line. Back in CK3's 1178 start, however, the Habsburg you can play is Count Albrecht of Aargau. Historically, he was the great-grandfather of Rudolf I of Germany, the first Habsburg king. Albrecht himself was known as Albrecht the Rich, thanks to his stewardship, and fittingly enough, he has the Midas touched trait in-game. As we expected, he wasn't married to a relative. This is because, as we've seen, the Catholic Church successfully prohibited close-cousin marriages in high medieval Europe, which might be the reason why we could not find any first cousin marriages in the game at all. Even outside the Catholic realms, the cousin marriages we know of from the Islamic world are not present in the game. For instance, if you find Harun al-Rashid in the title history of the Abbasid Empire, he is portrayed to have children, but his wife, Zubaydah, who in real life was allegedly his paternal cousin, is not shown in-game. However, as many CK3 players will know, while there are no such marriages in the starting date, it's entirely possible to set up consanguineous marriages yourself, and even to go for the so-called perfect circle achievement. That requires your character to end up with only two parents, two grandparents, and two great-grandparents. In other words, three generations of sibling marriages. My attempt to get there, probably quite similar to how people usually get this achievement, started off in Iceland, where in 1066 you can play as Jarl Isleifr, who has no family apart from his son Tater. Historically, Isleifr Gissursarson was the first bishop of Iceland and Greenland, appointed by Adalbart of Bremen. He actually had three sons. Thorvaldr? Sorry, Icelandic fans. Tater and Gissur, and a wife named Dalla. We also know that Tater, the youngest, later became a chieftain and priest, and is considered the ancestor of the Haukdalr family. Still, in the game, he only had this one son, Tater, and so I figured this would be the character that would one day become the single great-great-grandfather of the character we want to breed. So I married him off to this Norwegian woman, called Rögenfrider. Soon, Isleifr died, and I continued to play as Tater, and so now I would have to make sure the church could not stand in the way of my children's future love. This is why I chose the learning lifestyle with theology focus, in order to break away from Catholicism and make my own rules. I was trying to get the profit learning perk to get a 50% discount on faith creation and reformation. Once I was there, I clicked on Catholicism and then on Create New Faith. I realized despite the discount, I still needed a lot more piety than I had. So I hired some experienced ship captains and mercenary guards and decided to go all in on a pilgrimage to Jerusalem, which, from Iceland, was quite the trek. When I finally had enough piety, I founded my new Christian faith of perfect circleism that not only allowed consanguinity via having unrestricted marriage, but even encouraged it with the tenet divine marriage. I then had my son and heir, Tater Jr., marry his sister, Saga. And as we have seen earlier in our research of the Paradox Wiki, the game gave the risk of their children having the inbred trait as 15%, which, as also mentioned, already is probably portrayed as too small a risk. In reality, it should be more like 25%. As backup, I also betrothed the younger daughter to the younger son. So now I got the heir and the spare. Tater's first grandson, Tater, did not actually get the inbred trait, but he did get the giant trait, which is also one of the negative traits you risk getting from consanguineous marriages in CK3. But that doesn't affect his fertility, and also he's a massive beast. Because you need three generations of this to get the perfect circle achievement, once Tater died, I had to continue the same strategy with Tater Jr., following a temptation focus to increase his fertility and get as many children as possible to have some good marriage candidates. When I betrothed the next heir, Giant Tater, to his sister, Rögenfrida Sagasdottir, they already had a 27.7% risk of having inbred offspring. The game referred to Saga as your sister wife, sounding like something straight out of Game of Thrones. Meanwhile, my nephew, the first son of my older brother and sister, turned out scaly. Jarl Tater Jr. and his sister wife Saga had three sons and three daughters, perfectly pairing up in three couples that could potentially be my way to the perfect circle achievement. But this extra cautionary measure seemed to be unnecessary because my now adult giant son and heir, Tater, soon gave my character and two new grandchildren who I hoped would finally complete the circle when I swiftly betrothed them to each other. Well, the son of the giant ironically inherited the dwarf trait, but I still had nobody with the inbred trait. Anyway, when he inherited the Icelandic throne from his father, Tater the Giant, I should have gotten the perfect circle achievement, but somehow it did not work. Some people online said that it could be to do with my version of the game, or that perhaps one of my taters was actually cheated on by a sister wife, bringing in healthy gene material and messing up my perfect circle. Anyway, I did get the achievement, keeping it in the family upon the inheritance, for my first child with the trait inbred. The whole exercise showed that CK3 makes inbreeding remarkably survivable. In reality, the risks would be much higher, and genetic collapse would set in long before. If anything, the game underplays the dangers. So, what about you? Have you tried going for the perfect circle yourself? Did you manage it, or did your dynasty get derailed by some inconvenient fresh DNA? And have we overlooked any first cousin marriages hidden in CK3's start dates? Let us know in the comments. And as always, like and subscribe to our channel to see more from us. I'm off to delete my internet history. See you next time for more history in bits.